Hey everyone! In the previous videos, we discussed what functional programming is and its benefits in day-to-day tasks. Everything we have learned so far can be applied to most programming languages. For example, we can use FP functions in Kotlin, C#, or even JavaScript. Today, I would like to talk about some additional points specific to Scala and the JVM. I like to call this the Scala functional subset. The Scala functional subset consists of using FP functions everywhere in our codebase, plus two additional requirements. In this video, we'll cover the first. The first point concerns null. Null is a valid value for any reference in Scala, meaning for anything defined using the class or trait keywords. For example, we can define a case class called item, containing a name, a quantity, a unit price, and a VAT type. VAT represents the percentage of VAT that is applied to the item. It's an enumeration with only two possible values. It's either reduced, where the VAT is 5%, or standard, where the VAT is 20%. We can then create a couple of values of type item using the constructor of the class. As you can see, null is a valid value for both the name and VAT fields because string and VAT types are both classes. We can also define an item using null since it's a case class. However, if we try to assign null to a primitive type such as int or double, we would get an error. The error message is far from clear, but it basically means that we can't use null for quantity and unit price. So what is wrong with null? The problem with null is that it's almost everywhere. All the references can be null. And if we try to call a method or access a field on a null, we would get an exception, the infamous null pointer exception. Let's have a look at a few examples. Say we want to calculate the total price of an item. A typical implementation will multiply the unit price by the quantity and then apply the VAT rate on top. As you can see, this works fine for book, but if we try to call total price with an item having null in the VAT field, then we would get a null pointer exception. This is because null doesn't have a rate value. We will also get the same result if we call total price with a null item. In this case, we can't access the quantity, unit price, or VAT fields. We could potentially fix this issue by using multiple if-then-else to check whether item or the VAT field are equal to null. However, this approach is error-prone because nothing forces us to do these checks, so we often forget them in practice. Even worse, handling null makes the code difficult to read and test, because we have to consider multiple branches, even for something as simple as calculating the total price. So, what's the solution? It's quite unusual, but there is a sort of agreement across the entire Scala community. We collectively decided to ignore the existence of null in the Scala programming language. In practice, this means that 1. We don't write functions that return null. 2. We don't assign null to variables. And 3. We don't check for nulls. It may seem a little bit reckless, but so far it has worked out pretty well. Personally, I've only experienced a handful of null pointer exception in almost a decade of working with Scala. In fact, most of these occurrences were not caused by null directly, but because I defined variables in the wrong order. For example, here default rate references a variable down the line, but variables are initialized from top to bottom, which means that when we call defaultVat.rate, defaultVat hasn't been initialized. It's currently null, and that's why we get an error. This issue is a bit annoying, but both the compiler and IDE will give us a warning, so in practice, we rarely fall into this trap. In my opinion, the reason why nulls are so rare in Scala is due to having a better alternative in the standard library, the option type. We can assume all fields are mandatory by default, except if their type is option of something. For example, here we express that a user must have a name and an age, but it's possible they don't have an email because it has type option of string. This is the other way around in SQL. All fields are nullable by default, but we can make them mandatory by adding a not null modifier. Another benefit of option is that it forces us to consider the scenario when the data is missing. For example, suppose we want to calculate the VAT rate, but only have an option of VAT. In that case, we will need to pattern match on the option to access the VAT object inside it. But in doing so, we are forced to consider the case where the option is none. Finally, option is used throughout the Scala standard library, which, you know, sets an example. There are, however, two use cases where you might need to handle null directly in Scala. The first is if we interact with Java code. One of the benefits of Scala is that we can leverage the entire Java ecosystem. For example, instead of writing a library that reads an Excel spreadsheet from scratch, we can simply reuse a Java library such as Apache Poi. The API may not be perfect, but it saves us lots of time and effort. The downside is that null is fairly common in Java, so we can't ignore it. Otherwise, we would be running into lots of null pointer exceptions. In this example, we call the method getCell on the row type from Apache Poi. As you can see, we can read a text cell or a numeric cell. But if we attempt to read a cell with no data, getCell returns null. An easy way to sidestep this issue is to use the option constructor. Indeed, the apply method on the option companion object checks if the argument is null, and if it is, it returns none. This means that we only need to wrap the call of getCell with option, and it will handle null values automatically. This technique is much more ergonomic than ifs and else statements. However, it's still easy to forget to wrap every single Java method call with option. A better approach is to create a wrapper for the Apache Poi data model. Here I've defined a class SafeRow, which wraps an Apache Poi row. SafeRow is in charge of doing all the validations. It checks if the row and cell exist, and whether it contains the correct data type. In other words, we encapsulate all the handling logic for null and exceptions within the class SafeRow, and offer a functional API to the rest of the application. Now, let's talk about the second and final scenario where we should consider null in Scala. You might want to use null if you wish to implement low-level, highly performant code. Indeed, wrapping and unwrapping option add some overhead. And if we use it in a tie loop, you know, something that runs a lot, then it might impact the performance. It's extremely unlikely that you will ever need to do this. Still, if you look at the code of performance-sensitive libraries, such as CatsEffect, you might see some low-level code that look like this one, so don't be surprised. That said, I will really avoid writing this sort of code as much as possible, because it's error-prone and very difficult to maintain. So we should only do this when the extra performance is absolutely critical to our program. In summary, we have discussed how the Scala community has chosen to ignore null completely, instead preferring option because it offers a safer approach. We also explore two exceptions to these rules. One, when interfacing with Java libraries, and two, when developing performance-sensitive code. Now, if you still don't like the idea of ignoring null, you will probably be pleased to hear that Scala 3 is introducing a compiler option to remove null as a valid value for references. For example, if we try to assign null to a value of type item, then we would get an error. However, should we wish to, we can reintroduce null using another feature from Scala 3, the union type. For instance, we can say that this variable has type item or null, which will let us use null again. We'll talk about union types in more details in the final chapter when we cover error handling. Okay, that's it for today. I hope you enjoyed this lesson, and I will see you soon for the next video. Bye! Don't forget to check out my website, fp-tower.com, to get access to all my functional programming content and sign up for my course. See you soon!